Moves like a strong, powerful commander who despises the heavenly ruler because of his weakness and has usurped the leadership in affairs of state. But when the primal castle can be fortified and defended, then it is as if a strong and wise ruler sat upon the throne. The eyes start the light circulating like two ministers at the right and left, who support the ruler with all their might. Hello and welcome once again to The Secret of the Golden Flower. I just spent 2 or 3 days counseling and negotiating with people about teaching this path. And what I discovered is what seems to be an insurmountable problem. And the difficulty is that our language, our concepts, our model of the world, of reality, is based on the principle of positivism. Positivism means this is. Now, there's another path, which there's not a good antonym for positivism. If there was, it would be negativism. I think most people actually follow confusism because they're very, very confused about the difference between these two paths. Yoga follows positivism. It's called via positiva, the positive path. Yoga is based on will, on discrimination, on the use of concepts to grow the intelligence, on the use of objects to make distinctions, to lead to, well, actually, the yogi, if you ask a yogi, what is the ultimate objective of your path, they have a hard time explaining it. Gets into all kinds of squishy metaphysical concepts, real fuzzy logic. But the negative path is not based on will. It's based on love or surrender. It's not based on discrimination. In fact, it's based on dropping differences. That doesn't mean everything is one. That's another misunderstanding. But that's another video. But the via negativa is based on the opposite concept of emptiness. Now, the secret of the golden flower is based on the Buddha's path. And the Buddha's path is ultimately via negativa. However, because the Buddha was preaching or teaching people who had been trained in yoga, in the beginning, the Buddha's path seems to be another via positiva. Learn this, do that. Follow these principles, use your intelligence, and so on. Do this work and get the result. So far, we've been describing the path in terms of paticca-samuppada. Go back and watch earlier episodes if you don't understand this concept, or watch the Foundation series all the way through, please. And you will understand that in the beginning, there is something to learn. There is something to do. You have to master the process of becoming until you can become anything you want. And then you get confidence, mastery, not faith, but competence, confirmed verification of the teaching. Now, a funny thing happened on the way to enlightenment. I don't know why I make these silly jokes. I'm just trying to keep it from being too bloody serious. But it is really serious. So, okay, I'm going to be serious. The beginning of the path may be via positiva, just to get people engaged, just to get them started. But once you get to the first level of enlightenment, or even before that, you see this is not about positivism at all. This is about the opposite. This is about emptiness, nothingness, no thingness, non-becoming, non-being. Okay? The Buddha's path is a path of non-becoming. It is a path of emptiness. Okay? Now, the thing is, emptiness cannot exist within being. Being will destroy it. Because being has to see everything in terms of existence, of becoming. It has to see everything as an object. So, when people first approach the Buddha's teaching, what they do is they objectify it. Instead of a process, they consider it as a thing. Instead of a mystical path based on emptiness, they make it a religion based on doing and knowing. But in the higher stages of the Buddha's path, it's the complete opposite. Now, I have heard, I don't know from experience, but maybe you guys can confirm this for me, that there's a certain stage of the Masonic initiations where you find out that everything you have been taught up to that stage is bullshit. I think it's like the 24th level or something like that. Degree, 24th degree. I've heard through Aleister Crowley, I don't know. But it's something like that. It's something like you get to a certain stage in the Buddha's teaching and you find out that everything you had learned so far is wrong. Is backwards, inside out, upside down. Any way that is possible to be wrong is wrong. I shouldn't laugh because it's crushing. When it happens, it's like, oh my God. Because the Buddha's path is ultimately about realizing emptiness. Emptiness, as I said, cannot exist within being. Being will try to make it into a thing. And it's not a thing. It's emptiness. The absence of things. The absence of being. The absence even of becoming. The impossibility of becoming. Try to grasp this as much as possible. I know it's difficult. I know it's hard. Everything that you've experienced so far and everything that you have learned and been taught and everything that you've heard about the spiritual path is pretty much based on positivism. Yeah, take this course, get this realization, realize this thing, realize that. Even the Buddha's four paths are called attainments, as if they are things. This is called objectification. It's a big word. Six syllables. Oh my God. Poor babies. One of the problems I face in teaching this path is that there is a tremendous anti-intellectual bias in spiritual circles. They think if it's not something you can explain in words of one and two syllables, then it must not be true. But I'll tell you this, there are many things that cannot be expressed in ordinary language. They have to be expressed in a special terminology called Dhamma talk. Now, Dhamma talk is simply the same words of ordinary language, but using different definitions. So when we say emptiness, we don't mean emptiness in the same way as saying, well, I drank all the tea, so the cup is now empty. What we mean is a condition, a space, a dimension where not only there is nothing, including no boundaries, but where there can be nothing, where the process of becoming can't even get started, because there's no split, no distinction between subject and object, no difference between the past, present, and the future. Therefore, consciousness is impossible. Motion is impossible. Location is impossible. Everything that we assume, everything that our language takes for granted. Huh? Put this cup over there. See, they make so many assumptions that there is space, that there is time, that there are boundaries, there are locations, there is motion, physics. I mean, everything comes in as assumptions. And to save time, we simply assume that these things are true. And in the world of ordinary objects and getting ordinary stuff done, they are true. So no problem. The problem is when we move out of that domain into the domain of self-realization, there is only so far you can go with positivism. This was my experience. This was a big life experience for me. Let me tell you about it. My first actual real life teacher. Neem leaves. Was teaching Vedic Vaishnavism, Bhakti Yoga. And in Bhakti Yoga, of course, everything has being. In fact, eternal being. Unlimited being. And they redefine the term transcendental to refer to anything that they like. Anything that they think is good is transcendental, right? But actually, these things that they call transcendental are simply objects. Maybe they're subtle objects. Maybe they are highly spiritualized, very elevated karmically, and much, much longer lasting than any human existence. But because they still exist, they still come under the heading of being. And because they have being, they can also have non-being. In other words, they're temporary. Now, this universe has three characteristics which are inseparable from being, along with all the other things we already mentioned, like space, time, motion, etc. You have non-eternity, anicca or anitya. And then you have dukkha, suffering, or it can simply mean unsatisfactoriness. And finally, you have anatta or anatma, meaning non-self. So these three things apply to all objects. Anicca, dukkha, anatta. They are temporary, they cause suffering, and they are not self. anything actually that we can perceive, anything that we can be conscious of, is not self, because the self is only awareness. Even consciousness is not self, because consciousness is always consciousness of something. It has to have an object. There has to be duality. See? People say, okay, I've realized the oneness. I'm beyond duality. And I say, well, what does that mean to you? Well, I see the light. Well, that's very nice. It means you have concentration. You have jhana to some degree. But if you can perceive anything, even the light or the one or God or whatever you want to call it, Brahman, that is still duality. Actually, there is no such thing as duality. It's trinity. Because you have the subject, the object, and their relation. Huh? We've talked so much about ontological triples and all of that. That's what that refers to. There is no such thing as duality. No such thing as oneness. Either you have triplicity, trinity, threeness, subject-object relationship, or you have nothingness, emptiness, shunyata. Now, the yogi does not get emptiness at all, because yoga is a path of the will. It has an object, the self. It has a process that leads to certain attainments, certain powers, etc., etc. It can be quantified. It can be analyzed. It can be made into a certification. To be a yoga teacher these days, you have to be certified. Ridiculous idea. Just ridiculous. But anyway, because yoga is a positivist path, all these things are possible. Yes, they do lead to the degeneration of the whole thing into a commercial business. But that's what happens with positivist paths. Every religion has gone through the same degeneration. It's inescapable. Because, why? Anicca, dukkha, anatma. See? As soon as you assume positivity, as soon as you assume subject-object relationship, then you are headed towards death, dissolution, impermanence, suffering, not self. That is the nature of being and becoming. So, Dave, why did you just spend several videos teaching us about becoming? Because you have to become something more than you are now to even grasp this path, to even begin this path. And so those secrets bring you to the doorway. Now, when you get to the door, you look through, and there's nothing. Infinite emptiness. You recoil from it. The mind tries to escape from it. Go back into anything, any kind of beingness, any kind of thingness. You see? And because of that, if you take a path based on emptiness, like the Buddha's teaching, and you put it in a context or an environment based on positivism, the positivism will destroy it. Just the way Buddha's teaching has become destroyed by religions surrounding it. I mean, they literally killed thousands and millions of Buddhists in India and kicked Buddhism out of India because of this. So the Buddha's teaching has been violently attacked. I've been violently attacked in a positivist social framework for teaching this stuff. So, When you get to a certain point on the path, this door opens, the door to emptiness, to nothingness. And if you're like most people, you step back. You can't deal with it. You're afraid. It feels like death. And it is death. The death of positivism. The death of all your conditioning, the ego, the mind, everything. It takes enormous courage to go through that door. And guess what? The door is always open. There is no door. We put up the walls and we put up the door and close it and lock it. Not with an ordinary lock, with a blast-proof vault clock, you know, timer clock with an atomic override. So nobody's going to get through that door, but it's our door. If you think the door to enlightenment or the door to God or whatever it is closed, that's not the real door. That's your door. That's your side of the door. When you open your side, you find there is no door. There is no walls, no boundaries, nothing. It's so beautiful. I wish you could understand. So, negativism or emptiness cannot exist in a context of positivism, of being, of becoming. However, being and becoming can exist in a context of emptiness. And in fact, that's the way the world is, isn't it? Everything exists in space. Everything that has being exists in a context of nothing, of emptiness. So that's really the way the world is. Yet we have constructed this whole false, illusory, hallucinogenic world based on this language that makes everything into a thing. But it's not a thing. Reality is not a thing, can't be a thing. Enlightenment can't be a thing. Awareness can't be a thing. It's the absence of things. Think about it for a minute. What happens when you're totally engaged in something, totally busy? Your whole mind is absorbed and your whole energy is absorbed in doing something, you know, something very demanding, skiing, for example, or martial arts or music. And then your phone rings. It's like, I don't have any more room for this. Get out of here. Isn't it? You run out of space. You have no space for it. Huh? Why? What does that mean? Your awareness, your space, is full. So, that's because our awareness, we think even our awareness is a thing and we limit it. Not realizing that awareness is a no thing. It's the absence of something. So, things can exist within emptiness, and in fact they do. But emptiness cannot exist within things, or it dissolves them. What would happen, for example, if a black hole penetrated the earth, even a very small one? It would just chew up the whole planet. Huh? A black hole is an emptiness. It's a nothing. A hole in space-time. And, I mean, assuming that they actually exist, which has not yet been proven. But if they do, a small black hole
microscopic even. If it came in this planet, it could completely just eat it up, digest it. Now, lucky for us, if something like that actually happened, it's likely the black hole would be moving so fast, it would just go right through the planet and wouldn't destroy it completely. It would still mess it up, though. Because even a tiny microscopic black hole has a mass of millions of tons. It's crazy, isn't it? Emptiness can have an effective mass of millions of tons. Go back to our discussion on the vortex. A vortex of water acquires more mass and more kinetic energy than the same amount of water moving at the same speed because of the turbulence around the vortex. The turbulence, the randomity, the entropy around the vortex creates what I call fake mass or fake matter. And it'll hit you much harder than the equivalent of an unbroken wave. Go down to the beach and test this. Damn it, I'm not talking through my hat. If you don't understand the terms, it's your problem. Get your dictionary out. When a certain mass of water is moving as a wave and it hits you, you just bob up and down and that's it. But when that same water is in a vortex, when the wave is breaking and it hits you, wham, smash, wipe out. Why? Because the turbulence around the vortex increases the effective mass. Kaboom! Hits you like a ton of bricks. It makes the water stiff. Water is nice and soft, isn't it? Just put your hand in, it goes in, nice, easy. But if you hit that water hard, you do a belly flop, you know? Go off the diving board and get it wrong, flap. It feels like a wall. Why? Because your impact creates turbulence and it makes the water stiff and hard. See? I may be using language in a way that you've never heard before. And so it's hard for you to grasp it. It's hard for you to get it. And this is the problem with trying to teach the secret of the golden flower. I was negotiating with someone who has a yoga center. Okay. And basically, they were saying, okay, if you want to come and teach this stuff, you have to fit into our program and teach it as a part of our yoga, our certified yoga bullshit. And I'm going, no, no, you can't. It can't be quantified. It can't be characterized. It can only be done by individual instruction because everyone is different. Everybody has a different set of wrong concepts that needs to be deconstructed. Yeah. Certain of them are common to all, like space, time, mass, movement, and so on. Like, yeah, consciousness, etc. Well, yeah, that's common to everyone, but the details are different in every case. So a method that works for one person is not going to work for another person. What allows one person to realize emptiness won't have any effect on another person, simply because of the way their mind's put together. That means it has to be individualized. I can teach anybody in, I don't know, 60 or 70 hours how to reverse the flow. And once they learn, then they can go out and practice by themselves and do their 100 days of practice. 100 days means, you know, like 8 hours or more a day of practice to get enlightenment, to get stream entry, first path. But to learn it is actually not that difficult. I could do it in a week. I mean, it would be a pretty intense week, but yeah. You can learn this thing in a week and then go off and practice on your own and get it. And however long it takes you, that's up to you. But It can't be made a certification. It can't be made a quantification. It can't be made, 12-step process or whatever. Yeah, there are 12-step processes incorporated in it, like paticca-samuppada. But the process of the golden flower itself cannot, absolutely cannot fit into that kind of program. Because it's via negativa. It's a path based on emptiness. Emptiness can accommodate your yoga path just fine. And when you get to a certain stage, as far as that path will go, then you can switch. Okay? That's what I had to do. I was going to tell you the story. Yeah. So I studied bhakti. I studied bhakti for like 30 years. And I got to the advanced stages of bhakti. I was having all the ecstatic symptoms. I was seeing all the visions. I was in the pastimes. I was getting bhava. Everything. The whole thing. I still have that. But to go any farther than that, I had to switch from a positivist to a negativist path, from the via positiva to via negativa, from an objective-oriented path to an emptiness-oriented path, the Buddha's teaching, to Osho. Now, the funny thing is, I learned Secret of the Golden Flower from Osho. And I went off and practiced by myself, and I got it in like 55 days, 60 days, something like that. But I didn't know what I was doing. I didn't know the philosophy behind it. I had no background in paths based on emptiness. I only knew positivism. But despite that, just by doing the practice, I got it. And why was that? Because I was out from the positivist environment. And I was being supported by negativist energy. Osho's energy. So I was successful. It took me another 30 years to go into the Buddha's teaching, out of almost like desperation, to find out what was it he was doing. How did this thing work? Even though I was, I have deep background in Sanskrit and Vedas and Tantras and everything, I couldn't figure out how this thing worked and what happened to me. And I sure couldn't reproduce it until I went deep into the Buddha's teaching. And when I did, finally I understood. And it immediately rehabilitated all the realizations that I had got from Osho. It immediately, as soon as I recognized that, oh, this is first path. Oh, okay. I got everything back. All the abilities, all the realizations, the consciousness, everything. So, of course, there's still three more paths to go. But that was when things really turned around for me. So, I'm taking my time and explaining this carefully so that those of you who have been following along this whole series will understand the overall architecture, the overall big view, the big picture, that what we are trying to do is no less than create a new context based on emptiness, which can include positivism, no problem, but which also leads at the appropriate point in the path to switch to the via negativa. Now, I'm sorry if people have philosophical misunderstandings, if they have intellectual problems, if they have learning disabilities, I totally understand. But we have already given all the methodologies for overcoming those problems in previous videos. So if you don't understand this, it's not my fault. You can go back, you can watch those videos, you can get your dictionary, look up the words, do the work. Do the work. This is not cheap. Enlightenment is the greatest luxury, the greatest opulence, the greatest fortune, and the greatest bliss. And that's the real nature of the secret of the golden flower.